Yo, K-Pace guy, here's what's going on. Welcome back to the channel, and welcome to another Q&A with K-Pace guy. This is a really good little series that I like to do to give you guys a chance to ask any question you may need an answer for, and I do a video like this. So on the community tab on YouTube, I ask every 5 or 6 months, hey, ask me any questions you guys have, home theater, about me, whatever, and I will make a video answering all your questions. So it's really nice and easy. Instead of trying to find a video that may have your answer, it's better to just ask me like this. I can tell you guys in case a lot of you guys have the same questions. So I have a list of questions in the community post here. Also, before we continue, there is a playlist called Q&A of K-Pace Guys. If you want to see other episodes of questions I've been asked, there is a playlist for that. But we're going to go off with a pretty strong question to start off. We're going to kick things off real good. And this is from DJ Derek Rock. And he says, first of all, thanks for all your videos and content, dude. You're welcome. My question is, in a budget setup with only 7 channels available, is it better to run a 5.1.2 or a 7.1 and forget the hype channels? I've always heard mixed answers for this. Yes, it's mixed answers because there isn't a right or wrong answer. It's more about your room, your receiver's power, maybe the speakers, the layout. There's a lot of things that will make one answer a better choice than the other. Me personally, if I can have Atmos speakers in the ceiling, I'm going to. I think they add more immersion in the air than the surround back speakers will do for you. So I personally think a 5.1.2 will be a better option than a 7.1. Reason being is because there's a lot of effects nowadays that happen above your head. Yes, surround sound happens around you. Oh my gosh, wow, cool, that was great. But having things fly over your head or zip past you in a more realistic way really adds to the movie far better, in my personal opinion, than surround back speakers. Now, surround back speakers are really important because when things go from front to back, you actually want them to be behind you. And if you're only running 5.1.2, that means your 4 and 5 speaker, your left and right, are on the sides. So when things fly past you, they're not actually going past you. They're going and stopping on the side of you. So that's why there's an argument for it. But me personally, I am absolutely in love with a properly set up Dolby Atmos system. If you can put those speakers where they're supposed to be, above head, angled correctly, get the right type of speakers, I think you'll get more of an immersion from that, and your side surrounds will do a pretty good job of taking care of the surround duties. But if you can't properly put your Atmos speakers where they're supposed to go, if you can't properly purchase the right kind of Atmos speakers, then I think you're better off with a 7.1. All right, next question is from LA Space Boy. He has a couple different questions here. He asks, one, can you share what you do on the outside and parallel with YouTube? Yes, I work at Toyota, not the plant. I don't build the cars, but I sell them. I'm a salesperson at my local Toyota, and I sell cars, new or used. If you need anything, hit me up. Number two, he asks, what are your hobbies outside of home theater, like gym, camping, food, etc.? I love the gym. I've always been athletic nerd. Athletic family. I played almost every sport that I could, and so I still try to be active. I love being outside. If I'm not in front of the camera inside or watching a movie inside, I am 100% outside, going on hikes, riding bikes, walking. I love being outdoors, so you can find me there, or you can find me in the gym. And of course, I love sports. If I can play some sports, I will. He says, number three, what's your top 3 to 5 favorite movie demos for sound, visual, or both? Any Dolby Atmos demo disc has really good clips from a lot of movies. I personally always go to Ready Player One. I always go to Hacksaw Ridge because it has some of the craziest Atmos effects. Visually, I don't really think that hard about it because 4K movies just look great in general. So I don't really have like my go-to 4K demo. I more so demo sound than I do visual because 4K content is a lot easier to find than Atmos content. So I kind of don't have a favorite. I just kind of know what's good, and I just tend to choose that every time. He says, number four, regardless of sound and visual quality, your go-to movie you can watch over and over, guilty pleasure. Nothing. I don't have a movie that I watch over and over again. Although, the movie that I have watched the most is Orphan. If you haven't seen it, go look it up. I'm not going to tell you about it. Go watch it. Number five, if you didn't buy the KEF speakers you have now, which are the R11s, what other speaker brand in the same price range or less would you have highly considered? I really, at some point, want to have Paradigm speakers in my listening room, whether that's in this house, in the next one, whatever, because growing up, I thought they were like the best thing. I always wanted Paradigm speakers as a younger kid. I have not had them yet, and I don't really think I've even too much heard them. So I definitely want Paradigm speakers at some point. I also want to hear and maybe even own some Triton speakers, Triton ones, whatever, because they are like a better version of a DefTech speaker, but they're so high quality, and the bass that comes out of them without a sub, because they have subs built in, is amazing. So I definitely want to go to Paradigm or a Triton speaker probably next, if I didn't buy the Kef R11s, but that's pretty much it off the top of my head. All right, we have a question from LowSir7280, and he asks, I have a Klipsch R610F Towers. What center would you recommend? I recommend pairing them with the one that they have in the package. So whatever the matching center is, or a step above that. But don't mix and match brands, especially not the front stage. Keep it all the same. If you have the space for it, it's always good to get three identical speakers. So if you have the height and the space for a third tower, that's always number one choice. Most of us can't do that, like myself. So go for the center channel that's within the same model line or better. That's my suggestion for you. So this is a really good question I have not been asked before on my time on YouTube. And this person says here, Ray's TW, I have a Yamaha VX485, more their entry level receiver, and I'm running YPOW, which is their processing, their calibration system. I'm running YPOW sounds off. Someone told me I should run it multiple times and Yamaha will average out all of them together. Is that true? Nothing in the manual says this will happen. Thanks, Tia. No, it will not average it out. It will probably always very closely, if it's a good system, will always pretty much be the same. It might change a little bit because you might move your microphone a little bit, or you might stand in a different spot, or maybe you move the pillow or whatever. So it'll be slightly different, but on average, it'll be pretty much the same. Now, there are really technologically advanced receivers and preprocessors that will state if it can do that, and then it will average. But most receivers out there that you can buy today do not do that. And I promise you, if they could, your manufacturer will tell you, because it's a selling point. So if it doesn't say that on the manual, if it doesn't say that in the calibration setup, don't assume that it does. Whoever told you that it did, his may, but he may have, you know, a $10,000, you know, processor or something that does it or whatever. But no, it will not average anything. When you press YPOW or Odyssey or whatever, as soon as you press it, it erases everything in its memory and starts all over. So whatever you did before, it does not care. It just does all over again. All right, so we have a really good question here from Mauricio B8260. He said, I added to my Denon X3700H receiver some external amplifications for my front stage channels and my height 1 and 2 speakers. The receiver is powering the surround left and right, as well as the back surround speakers. The amp does not have volume control, so the volume is controlled only through the receiver. But why do I feel there is no power for my speakers? To get a nice punchy sound, I have to crank the volume to almost 10 dB. Already did the speaker calibration. All my speakers are set to 75 dB, and the reference test tone volume in my receiver was at 0 dB. All right, so his problem is he was expecting maybe a sound increase, or maybe he didn't have to turn it up as loud to get the same volume. That's not how amplifiers work. Amplifiers have sensitivity ratings. Sensitivity means how well can that amplifier turn electricity or power into sound. So if you look on every single speaker, every single amplifier, every single receiver, you'll see a signal to noise ratio or a sensitivity rating. And the higher that number, the better it is at that receiver's amplifier or your external amplifier at turning its power into sound, so that you don't have to turn the volume up so loud. It's basically an efficiency weighting. How efficient is your amplifier at turning its power into sound? The higher that number, the better the efficiency, the less you have to turn the volume knob up. The problem that you're having is that you expected to have a volume increase when you purchase amplification, but that's not how it works. Let's say you have a 50-watt receiver and it gives you 100 dB maximum. You have to double your power to get a 3 dB increase. So what does that mean? I have to go out and buy an amplifier that is twice as powerful to only get a 3 dB increase. So if my 50-watt amplifier gives me 100 dBs, and I buy a 100-watt amplifier, I'll get 103 dBs. So if I want to gain another 3 dB of volume, I have to go and double up my power again. So I got to go from 100 to 200 watts to get a total of 3 dB, which is 6 dB more than where I started. So if you guys are following me, power does not equal volume necessarily. Power equals efficiency and the ability to drive your speakers at those higher volumes. It doesn't necessarily give you a higher volume. It performs better at higher volume. So you may have been wondering why you still have to turn your receiver up. There's a lot of variables with it, but I'll just leave it at amplifiers don't necessarily add a whole bunch of volume. They just make it a lot easier for your speakers to drive. It makes it easier for you to have higher volumes. It keeps the work off your receiver. It gives you true power rating, but it's not necessarily going to increase your volume. If you're having a volume issue, after you run calibration, go into your settings, go into your levels, and you can play around with your levels and increase that. That way you can get a little bit more volume. Now be careful, you don't want to just turn up all of your levels on all your speakers. That'll cause you problems, which I have a video on in my how-to playlist, but you can adjust those levels so that you get a little more volume back. So go into your settings after you ran calibration in your Odyssey setup and make some fine tweaks. I think that will be where you find your performance increase. All right, have a really cool question from Darth Gerald 1970. And it said, we're trying to upgrade our Atmos DTS:X receiver from 5.4.2 to 5.4.4. But most receivers are over 1500 with features that we don't need or would use. Even an older model is expensive. What Atmos DTS:X receiver would you recommend that wouldn't break the bank? Well, I think in order to get to a 5.4.4, you probably need to get rid of your receiver and start looking to some processors, because then you start running into things like ToneWinner or Emotiva, who have really nice budget preprocessors that will allow you to get into those higher configurations. But you're asking for a pretty wide channeled receiver. You're going to have to spend the money. It's just something that's going to happen. Now, you said something about along the lines of there's features that you won't use, but nowadays there's an industry standard. Most everything is going to have the same features, whether you like them or not. It's going to be there. It's not like a car where you have different trim levels. So if you don't want a sunroof or leather, then you can find the car that doesn't have that. But you can't really do that with receivers, because everything is industry wide. Everybody kind of makes similar stuff as far as features go. So you're going to have the same features in one model as you will in another model from another brand, just because it's competitive out there. That's how people pull you in. That's how you have, you know, manufacturer battles and blah, 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 right? So you can't really avoid the features, but I think you can avoid the receiver and move up to a preprocessor, and then you open your options, because receivers that have that many channels are crazy expensive, but you may be able to find a preprocessor that isn't as expensive. Now, with that being said, because you're running a preprocessor, you will need external amplification. Got to keep that in mind. So it may end up being the same cost at the end of the day. So basically, if you want what you want, you're going to have to fork the money for it. So save the money, find something you know is going to work in your environment, and be happy with that. That's really all you can do in this kind of hobby. This is an excellent question, and coming from David McKee, 2898. He asks, I'm still confused about the subwoofer crossover inside the amplifier. Some say it must be on 120 hertz because the sound engineer has to put special sounds with this crossover. And then some people will put it lower, let's say 90 or 80 hertz. So if I put it low, am I missing out? Fantastic question. So I'm going to use a Marantz receiver or a Denon receiver or something of the sort, right? If you go into the menus, you can see that you have a crossover for all your speakers, front left, center, front right, whatever. You also have a crossover in there for your sub, right? So you may want to set it to 80 hertz because that's what everybody tells you. If you go in there, you may have a second crossover called LFE crossover. LFE stands for low frequency effects. And that is what you were mentioning when you said some people say set it at 120 hertz. The reason why they say that is because when you're watching a movie, there are some parts in a movie where the sound engineer puts information about that high because they want you to feel that effect. So maybe a car door slam or somebody throws a grenade from a long distance. They want you to feel that. They want to emphasize that moment with the subwoofer, right? But that doesn't happen very often. So a lot of people will say, hey, set your crossover to 120 hertz because sometimes there'll be some information up there. But more times than not, you want to set your crossover to what makes sense with your speakers and your environment. So you can set it lower. Me personally, I have two different types of crossovers. I can set my LFE crossover to 120, so I still get that information if it's in the movie, but my overall subwoofer crossover is actually at 60 hertz because my tower speakers do really, really good in the mid-range bass. So if you have that second setting for LFE and you can change the LFE crossover to 120, do it. Because you can also set your subwoofer crossover to something different. If you don't have but only one crossover on your subwoofer in your receiver, then set it to what best makes sense for the majority of your sound. Don't set it to 120 just because maybe a movie will have it. Set it to whatever frequency will give you the best sound 99% of the time. For me, mine is 60 and I never touch it. All right, we have a pretty good question from Barley Leg, and he asks, thinking about trying amps again with my RZ50, that's from Onkyo, the receiver, don't feel like running a two-channel just for the rears again. Polk ES50, ES35 up front, ES15 and ES10 side and rear. Separate amp for front and backstage, or one 7-channel amp to rule them all? Note, the 7-channel amp I'm looking at is 130 watts for all speakers, meaning there will be an excessive unusable power to all four rears. Thank you for your channel and for all you do for us. Thank you. Thank you for watching. So he's basically asking, I have 7 speakers, should I get one 7-channel amp or should I get 2 separate amps? And the reason he asks, should I get 2, is because the amp he's looking for has more power than he needs for the rears, but it's enough power for the fronts. So he said one key thing in the very beginning of his question, which answered his question already. He said, don't feel like running a 2-channel for the rears again. Sounds like you just want to go 7 channels already, but I'll answer the question how you asked me it, right? So me personally, I think get one amplifier and rule them all, right? Because simply that's less equipment you have to buy and less equipment you have to find a house for. I don't have a lot of space in my house to have all these amplifiers, so having one big 7-channel amplifier has been great for me, right? So his problem is there's a lot of power in this particular amplifier that he's not going to be using. That's good. We want headroom. If you ever decide to crank it up, or you ever decide to move into a house with a bigger space, maybe you even want to upgrade your speakers in the future, you've already future-proofed yourself. Now you don't have to buy another amplifier to now handle your more power-hungry speaker that you didn't plan on buying, right? It just kind of came out of nowhere. Now you have an amplifier already ready to go. So I say go for that 7-channel amplifier, one, for the convenience of having a smaller footprint than 2, and then secondly, you don't have to worry about upgrading it in the future. Now, to speak on having unusable power, again, let's go back to the headroom comment I made. The headroom's great. You're always going to know, no matter what volume you turn your speakers up, that you're going to have the power you need. And to be honest with you, you don't really blow speakers very often in home theater. It doesn't really happen, especially not in the rears, because there's not a lot of bass that goes that way. Anyway, you have crossover set, so the power, all that power never really makes it to your speakers anyway. Like he was saying, it's unusable in a sense. You're never going to use all that power, but having that headroom means that you're never going to have to turn up the volume too loud to get all your power. You're going to always have enough headroom so you can just sit back, relax, and just enjoy the system, not worrying about fatigue, listening to straining, never worrying about underpowering your speakers. So go for that 7-channel amp and be happy with that one. I think that'll be the better choice for you in the long run. All right, so we have a question from the OpZone 670, golly, 6775, wish I could read. It says, are you using any UPS for your system at the moment, or will you later? If so, which one? Which would you use, or which one would you recommend for wattage? For example, I am using the Yamaha RX-A2A in a 5.1.2 setup. So UPS meaning uninterrupted power supply. I have one because it was sent to me by Sendavo a few years back to use as a video for you guys. Otherwise, I wouldn't have one. I think I did have one back in the day, a JP25 or something from APC, like a backup battery, and it had really good it's just really good for home theater. I think having one is always good. I will definitely have one when I go to, when I buy a house and I have a dedicated home theater system, I'll have one just to make sure that my system is clean, power is clean, it's protected. It doesn't cost that much. I mean, it can, but it doesn't cost that much to have one. So anything you can do to keep the audio filtered, make it clean, have a good sound, have it protected, I would do that. I don't really have like a wattage in mind as far as what's the best ones out there. Just do what's best for your system. And when you start spending a lot of money on your system is when you really want to consider all these things, uninterrupted power supplies, surge protectors, all that stuff. When you spend a lot of money on a system, it's just nice to have one just as like a reassurance that things will be relatively, you know, safe in the future. So I'm not like big on them. I'm not against them. I have one because one's given to me. So I guess that's my answer. So I think this question is more for car audio, but I still know the answer. So Pete across the street asked, I have a 4x150 amplifier, meaning I have an amplifier that gives me 150 watts times 4. Your front door speakers are 150 watts. The rear speakers are 120 watts. Also using a DSP. Should I gain to the DSP output 4 volt and turn down the volume on the DSP for the rears, or should I gain match the rear amp channels to the RMS of the rear speakers and set the DSP to full? Second option is the better answer, and here's why. You should maximize the DSP's full volume because assuming you took your head unit and found your clean volume, as long you know how high you can turn your system up before you reach distortion, assuming you know what that number is, everything coming to your DSP should be clean, meaning everything coming out should be clean. Now, don't set your DSP to full volume. Set it, I don't know, maybe 75-80% there so that you don't introduce a distorted sound through amplifiers. Don't go full volume, but go 85-80% of the way there. But gain match your RMS of your speakers to your amplifier so that you're getting enough power to your speakers at all times and nothing more, right? So your DSP set to its best signal, it'll give you a full 4 volts so that you don't have to turn your gain up very high on your amplifier and then gain match your amplifier to your speakers from that point on. It'll give you a cleaner sound and you can 100% avoid distortion. Don't have to worry about a single thing. Sit back and relax and enjoy your audio. So ending out the video with a question from Jasmine Miller, 453. She asks, how has the AVM70 from Anthem, the processor, how has the AVM70 been for you after almost 3 years? Well, I haven't smashed it with a hammer yet. I haven't replaced it. And I still use it every day. So I'd say it's doing pretty good. I have no itch to upgrade. I have not been looking on the market to see what else is out there. I have not been considering anything. I absolutely love it. I still hate the fact that I have to send it in for the 8K upgrade because it means I have to go, I think, 5 or more weeks without audio. And it's really hard to get myself to do that as a YouTuber because I use it for reviews. I use it to demonstrate movies and projector systems and do speaker tests and whatever. So I have it on all the time. So as a YouTuber, it's hard to send it away. It may be easy for a normal consumer. You go, you know, a month or two without it, you get it back, it's upgraded. But for me, I hate that. And it costs $500, which is more than it would have been had I just waited and got the 8K ready one already. So, hate that part. It's also not Rune certified yet, which is ridiculous. It's almost been 3 years, and I still can't use the Rune services that is slapped on the logo on the front of the box. I can't even use that yet. So that's still frustrating. Other than that, I absolutely love it. Sounds phenomenal. Everybody that's came in here to listen to it also says it's phenomenal, and it'll last me for a while. I'm going to try my best not to get rid of it when I upgrade, but I know that it will hold a lot of its retail value, so I probably will sell it for something else eventually. But as of right now, it's been great. All right, guys, a little bit longer of a video. Always happens when we have a question air video like this. Want to get as many questions in as I can. So what you want to do is be a subscriber, because when I post to the community page about another Q&A video, you guys will get a notification that says, hey, ask me some questions. So if you have questions that you want answered, be sure to take a look into my Q&A playlist. I may have already answered it, or keep a lookout for the next time that I post in the community page about a Q&A video so you can ask your questions there. Of course, if you leave me a comment in my videos, I always respond to every comment that needs a response. I see them all. So feel free to ask me questions in any video you guys are watching. Thank you guys so much for watching. Hit that like button and subscribe if you're not already. We will see you guys in the next video. K-Face Guy out. Peace. You can say I lost my mind. I will keep on holding my head high. Even if the sky is falling down.